Preparation is key ahead of a big match this weekend.
Sometimes it does spill over and naturally everything gets blown up in the press saying it was a 12 round bout and it went down to points. But, you know, those boys in that position, they have to have that edge. Otherwise, you know, you'd be losing.
Hello and welcome to the Offload Podcast. My name is Christina Mahan and I'm joined today by Dylan Hartley and Ryan Wilson. We are also very excited to have a new sponsor this week. Welcome to Dove Men Plus Care, who are a proud supporter of the Guinness Six Nations and are the official male grooming partner to all four home rugby unions. And thanks to Dove, we have some really exciting guests later in the show. George North and Jamie Ritchie will be joining us ahead of their showdown in Edinburgh on Saturday. How's it going, guys?
Very well. Victorious again, Scotland.
Dylan's very quiet.
I'll let him go. Go.
No, that's all I was going to say. Victorious again, Scotland against England. It's just, yeah, brilliant.
It was the first time, I think, since 1983 that Scotland have won at Twickenham.
Yeah, like, that's right. But the third time in the last four games that Scotland have retained the Calcutta Cup. So, you know, getting used to it now.
Why are you congratulating Ryan? He had nothing to do with it.
I feel like Ryan's because been hyping Scotland up since the start of this podcast. Yeah, he got behind his nation, his team.
I'm a Scottish supporter now, Dill.
Yeah. Okay. Well done,
so
Ryan.
That's why I'm getting congratulated. So as all the other Scottish fans all over the world with whatever accents they have, congratulations to you as well. All of you fans out there that deserve it.
Yeah, I swear, if the pubs are open, everybody would have been celebrating like a Scottish person on Saturday. But Ryan, now tell me truthfully, did you see the result coming?
Yes, I genuinely did. I know it's easy for me to sit here. You had me on last week and asked me my score prediction. Like, so many people had talked about it as well with the, you know, with the time that some of the Saris players hadn't played for, you know, on paper, Scotland are dangerous. And then they went out there and did the job. And, you know, you gave people like Cam Redpath his first cap. He's going to go out there and play well in these because he's going to do everything he can to do what he, you know, to perform in that shirt. And on paper, Scotland are strong, and I reckon just as strong as that England squad at the weekend there. So they went out and did the job, stuck to exactly the game plan they wanted to play, and I did see it coming. I'm telling you, I saw it coming, and I reckon a lot more people this year definitely saw it coming.
Well, lastly, before we come to Dylan, who's been very quiet so far, do you reckon there's going to be a national holiday now to mark the occasion?
No, because it's the norm now.
I'm just getting so used to winning now.
It's become a norm over the last 4 years.
Oh, Dylan, it must have been a very, very uncomfortable watch for you on Saturday. What did you make of it all?
Now, you say it's uncomfortable for me. Like, I thought about this. You know, when you play, Ryan, and you're emotionally invested and you care about it and you put so much into it, and when you lose, Sunday's terrible. You know, you wake up Sunday, you can't wait for Monday to come around. You're basically waiting for the next game to come around to redeem yourself. But as I've retired, I literally don't care. I go to the game. I support England. I know the players. They're my friends. I want England to do well. But, you know, when they lose, I don't take it home with me. You know what I mean? I don't go home and have a bad Sunday walk with the family. And, you know, I'm literally there doing a job. I'm being paid to talk about the game. And it's funny when people kind of slide into your DMs and just reminding you that England lost. I'm like, I don't care. It doesn't really bother me. But on the game, not taking away anything from Scotland, they did what they had to do. And if you think about it, Finn Russell missed three shots at goal, 9 points, turned down three shots at goal as well, which I thought was crazy in that weather. I'm surprised they turned them down. So, you know, I don't think like England threw a punch. They didn't fire a shot. They didn't do anything. So Scotland just did what they had to do, effectively. The challenge for them, how I see it, is consistency. Can they back it up next week and the week after? Can they do four or five in a row, you know, against big teams? So, you know, hats off to them. Some outstanding performances there. You know, Redpath, for me, there was so much kind of going on in the game. I was trying to think about what I could talk about from a positive England point of view. And I couldn't find much. But the fact that, for me, Redpath just slotted into that. You know, how old is he?
21.
Yeah, like he went unnoticed, which I think is a good thing. A couple of nice touches, nothing kind of glaringly obvious. didn't stick out like a sore thumb, you know, was not a weakness in that side. So I think for him, you know, brilliant debut. And yeah, a lot to for England to go away and work on and think about, I think.
Dylan, there was a lot of talk going into the game about England's Saracens contingent. Do you think that they should have been put into the starting 15 with such a lack of game time, or did Eddie get that wrong?
I mean, Sean Maitland went all right, didn't he?
Yeah, he did.
I think the question, everyone's kind of posing the question around like merit and form. He's got no form to go on. The last form he had from that Saracens contingent were in an England shirt. And merit's like credit, basically. Merit's not current merit, it's just merit. So I think he's got, those players have got credit with them, and he made a decision as a coach to put them in. And if I don't think that kind of four or five players were responsible for that performance. But when you look at the key influences that they are, 2, 4, 8, 10, 15, that's like the spine of your team. If the spine of your team isn't 100% at the races, it's hard for everything else to work. So I think Eddie's made a call there. You know, only he knows whether it was right or wrong. But then the question is now is like, what do you do with those players that we all perceive to be not at the races? You know, do you drop them, or do you give them more game time to get them up to speed? Like, you can't send the boys down to Cornish Pirates at the weekend, can you? Do you give them another run against Italy, or do you drop them out the squad? That's what everyone's suggesting. And I'm like, no. These are, you know, I'd say that spine of the team are world-class players, and they're capable of performing. Maybe that was just the blip, an unfortunate timing and blip for those players. But, you know, I can't see them performing like that again.
Have England got Italy this week, have they?
Yes.
So, yeah, see, that's the frustrating thing as well, because Italy were terrible. So they've got a game where they know he's going to be able to chuck those players out and they'll do well no matter what. Whereas if they had a tougher opponent this weekend, then he would have been under a lot of pressure to make some bigger changes. Whereas he knows, stick those boys out again this weekend, we'll get the result and it will be forgotten about. Whereas I reckon there'll be a lot of players like, you know, the likes of Sam Simmons, people like this, that are going, hold on a minute, what did Vunipola do at the weekend? Absolutely nothing. And he sat there going, well, he's getting another chance against a really poor opposition. I thought Italy were, you know, terrible at the weekend. And there's those guys sitting there going, well, they're just going to get another shot against an easy opponent. It all will be forgotten. That's what will be frustrating.
What you got to remember, though, is like we sit here and say, oh, we haven't seen players play since the autumn. And, you know, this guy's in form. Eddie has day-to-day contact with these guys. He sees and feels how they perform on the training field. He gets kind of feedback in terms of stats and fitness. You know, he knows if those guys are up to speed. And then ultimately, he's got the biggest privilege. He's the biggest fan out of all of us. He gets to pick his ultimate 15 at the weekend. So he's closest to it, and he's made a judgment call that only he knows whether it's right or wrong. So us sitting here deliberating on it, it's just like...
I can tell you one thing for sure. I saw Big Bill in that tight shirt, and he didn't look fit, mate. He didn't look fit. Jesus.
Mate, can I just say, white shirts are unforgiving. I reckon if you put the All Blacks in white shirts, you'd see some shapes as well.
Nah, they'd look good because of the tan. White always makes you look nicer when you've got a nice little tan.
Oh my gosh. No, white shirts, unforgiving. Just trust me on that. You were lucky enough to play in a dark blue shirt. Like, Big Bill is Big Bill. You know what I mean?
What's he like? What's he running, like a Bronco time in or fitness? Is he terrible?
Yeah, but is that relevant to what Big Bill does? You know what I mean?
I'm just asking for those out there. You know him. People will be going, how unfit is he, really? Because I know what he does on the field. And I know, like, I see the boys that I notice most, the Islanders, the Fijians, put them in a Bronco test, put them in a fitness test, worst people on earth. Put them in a game, turn up, like, just do stupid things. But is Big Bill one of them? Is he really unfit? You'll know this.
No, he's not. He's not. He's fit for purpose. Like, if you look at what Billy's role within that team is, it's to be a big ball-carrying number eight, a big physical presence in defence. The only problem I see with what happened was last weekend, there wasn't those moments in the game for him to use his strength.
Yeah.
You know, it's pointless having 130 kilo number eight that can run a Bronco sub 4 minutes 45. You know what I mean? Like, you want the boys fit for purpose. And for me, in that sort of weather, if England had ball in hand a bit more in the right areas of the field, those are the sort of players that you need to be kind of crashing into the gain line, creating quick ball to create space, you know, and not letting defences recover type thing. So, you know, I don't want to talk about the fitness of Billy, because I don't think he would have played if he was unfit.
Well, Clive Woodward said it was England's worst performance ever, and Delalio said that the team looked clueless. Would you both say that that was the worst you've ever seen England play? Not taking any credit away from Scotland, but...
No, I don't think it's the worst they've played.
Really? Do you think you've seen worse?
Scotland were just good.
They were just on fire.
I've never won a World Cup, so I'm not Lawrence Delalio. You know what I mean? I'm not a World Cup winning coach. I'm not Sir Clive Woodward. He's a sir as well. I mean, he can say what he wants effectively and no one can question it, because he can say, have you done what I've done? But I said this again the other day, like, when you're in the media, you know, it's a bit like playing. You've got to perform. And unfortunately, performing in the media isn't doing the basics really well and being Mr. Nice Guy. Like, performing in the media is a bit like, you've got to say things that keep you current and keep, you know, to keep you in work. And I think Lawrence saying that they look clueless or rudderless, I don't know what he said. I think there's a bit of truth behind that. I don't know about clueless, but they were dictated to by a good Scotland team, you know, and then they were chasing the game and they didn't know how to come back from that. You know, even at 11-6, that game was still there to be won at times, you know, and they couldn't find a way. I think that the worst performance ever is a ridiculous statement. I mean, you look at Eddie's win rate compared to Sir Clive's. Eddie's, I think, a good 7-8% clear in terms of win percentage. But the one thing that Sir Clive has over him is a Rugby World Cup. So I think he's... unfortunately qualified to say whatever he wants. Worst England performance ever, certainly not.
Well, what about what Mike Brown came out and said, that it was, you know, it was time to drop Owen Farrell? Do you agree with him on that?
He's brave. I mean, the last person that he piped up to gave him a smack and was Ben Teo, wasn't it? I mean, that's going to be interesting. I think everyone's forgot, like, because we're in lockdown and we don't have social events or dinners or, you know,
you're gonna have to see these people.
Yeah,
you're gonna have to bump into these people again. Like,
do you not feel do you not think that Mike Brown would kind of own what he said? So if he did bump into Owen Farrell, he'd be like, "Yeah, I did say that."
No, he wouldn't.
I disagree. Like, again, like, as much as he's a pain in the ass, Owen Farrell, when you play against him, look at like his record with England and what he's done with England. Like, he's not played rugby for a while. As I said, they'll go against Italy and do well this weekend and all will be forgotten. But, like, just the calls for dropping him straight off the bat, it's just ridiculous, isn't it?
We have a new segment over the course of the Six Nations in partnership with the all-new Isuzu D-Max, where our panel will pick a player each week who is the unsung hero of the round. So someone who went about their work under the radar, put in a real shift, and was the key to their team's success. Our fans had their say and have voted for Tadhg Byrne as the Isuzu unsung hero of the week. But Dylan, I just want to know, who caught your eye and why?
Well, there's one person that caught my eye pre-game, and there's no disrespect to the man. I haven't heard of him or seen him play. This is probably bring up some history that we played against each other. But George Turner, obviously only got 12 caps to his name. I was thinking, George Turner, he's getting a shot today. You know, atrocious weather, big game for him, up against Jamie George, who... you know, is the British and Irish Lions kind of front runner, or potentially was. And he just went about his work quietly, banged just about every line out. I think he only had one sort of, and it wasn't even his fault, hit 100% of his line out, went about his work quietly. And I think in that sort of game where your set piece is crucial in that sort of weather, I couldn't look past him. And, you know, bit of hooker love.
Fair enough. And what about Ryan?
I mean, he's been spoken about a lot, hasn't he? But Hamish Watson, for me, was just solid. Just solid. Everything he does on the field, turnovers, ball carries, he was incredible. And I stuck that post up he is looking more and more like William Wallace every day. It's difficult when you've got an English accent out there on the pitch, especially against England, but he is fully disguised there. With the name and the hairstyle now, unrecognisable, that's it. Scottish Seamus Watson. So yeah, I'd say him. Another one, if you want someone outside of that group probably that hasn't played a huge amount, Scott Steele, the nine that came on for Scotland. He was brilliant. He just came on, controlled the game really well, kicked really well for a guy that's not got many caps for Scotland and is quite new to the setup. He was really good. He was really good coming off the bench.
Awesome. Well, not bad for the first round. Well, thanks, guys. And thanks to Isuzu for their support. So if you head to isuzu.co.uk, you can be the first to test drive the all-new smarter, stronger and safer Isuzu D-Max. Right, well, Sunday's clash between Wales and Ireland didn't disappoint, and it brought us another thrilling encounter, with the Welsh just managing to hold on against an Ireland team reduced to 14 men for the majority of the game. So firstly, I have to get your reaction on Pete O'Mahony's red card. What did you both make of it, and was it right for him to be shown red?
Yeah, it was right to go red, eh, Dills?
100%. You know, like, we've been down this, I think it's a rugby incident. You know, rucks are pretty complicated, and when you look at things in slow motion definition, you can say, why didn't you do this, why didn't you do that, but you got to remember, like, if he doesn't secure that ball or clear that ruck, like, he's been hung out to dry on a Sunday Monday morning in the review, and then equally he's got to move 130 kilos, and there's only one way to move 130 kilos is to get horizontal. You can't bind on that guy first and, you know, politely kind of squat him out the way. You've got to use momentum. And do you know what? Whether it's right or wrong or lawful or not, that's what rucking is at international rugby. People going horizontal, committing their, you know, their force to moving another object. It's a difficult place, and it all happens so quick. Decision-making, everything. But yeah, head contact, red card, unfortunately for him.
Guys, I do want to move on just because I feel like we have to talk about this, and I think it's actually really important. So off the back of Sunday's game, social media came alight for all the wrong reasons, with a host of abuse directed at Billy Burns after he missed the penalty kick. You know, people have come out to tell him to fuck off back to England and that he's a disgrace to the sport.
Language on you.
I know. I'm reading out what's up. I was like, will I read this out? Will I not? I know it's so early in the morning. But, you know, it's kind of led to everyone from Hugo Monnier to Brian O'Driscoll and numerous media outlets publicly standing up for him. I even took to Twitter because I was just like, I'm sick of this. But do you think that with the continuous rise of social media, that fan abuse and trolling is getting worse? Like, Ryan, I know you laugh an awful lot of the time, but like, have you seen getting a lot worse lately?
It's so much worse. There's so many petty people that hide behind their Twitter handles. But I'll tell you, for those people that are writing that crap, is for every one shitty message, he's getting 20 good messages, you know, from people. And the other thing is, the messages he's getting people from on Twitter, like, it's the people that have his number that are texting him that he needs to worry about, the WhatsApps, you know, the messages that he's getting from family, friends, because they're the people that know them, you know. It's a disgrace. But that's it. I'm happy with it because I can just laugh it off. Some people, you know, we're talking about all this mental health stuff in the world at the moment and men's health and, you know, you just think those idiots at home that think, oh, do you know what, I'm going to jump on there and slag him off. Drop me out.
I think it's the same people are the ones that get behind the team as well. They're just not on there trolling. They're the ones that when they win, they're there clapping away. But then equally, when they lose, that they want to vent. It's like some weird form of emotion. And I think when you pick, people are cooped up in the houses and whatnot at the moment, you know, they can vent. This is an avenue for them to vent. It's not acceptable.
Do you not think, though, that, like, you know, with people been stuck at home, I saw an article about this and it was like, you know, you don't get the chance to vent, say, in the pub with your friends or, you know, just in somebody else's house. And I think sometimes the armchair pundits, like, unfortunately, to get heard now on social media, you have to be nasty, you know. I just, like Dylan, what advice would you kind of give to players that have been targeted in such vile attacks? I just don't like when people at the individual, there's just no need. I just, yeah. No.
Well, geez, I was around before Be Kind was a thing or mental health was a thing. You see some of the stuff I used to get and I still get, actually. It's very interesting. Here's a question for you. If the player does something naughty, does he deserve trolling?
What's naughty now?
Well, like punching Rory Best. Is that?
Well, that's it. Was Peter Omani as much to blame? I'm guessing Billy Burns got a lot more abuse than Peter Omani got on social media. But you'd look at that game and go, well, Peter Omani's more in the wrong than him. For those that don't know, that didn't watch the game, Billy Burns has gone to kick for the corner and he's missed it. Like, it is a mistake.
He's had to go for the corner, though.
Think how many mistakes people made throughout that game. That's what it always comes to, the last mistake. Like, we've had it with one of the boys at Glasgow missing that kick at the end. Everyone focuses on that one mistake. You've got to look throughout the whole game and realise all the mistakes that they've made. But that's what's so petty, is people are so quick to jump on it. And my heart went out to him. I felt so bad for him. Like, you know, young guy, early years of his Ireland career. Oh, but yeah, wind it in, people. Jesus. Yeah.
Well, Dylan, you know, have you ever, like you said, you've been subject to a lot of abuse over your career. Did you ever respond to someone when you felt like that they had just gone way too far? Did you ever bite on social media?
Yeah, so before this whole sort of be kind and trolling was actually a thing, I got yellow card against South Africa. And I got a whole lot of abuse online. And I just thought, you know, I'm not going to comment on any of it, but I just started retweeting everything that was sent to me just to make people aware of what gets sent. And it actually makes people look really stupid.
Yeah.
And I was hauled straight into the manager's office with the lawyer at the time, the QC for the England rugby team. And they told me to take them all down. And I had to be kind of told to take those things down because it was not good. It wasn't a good look. And I just didn't really get that. So I think we're making massive sort of inroads in that sort of space. And if you look at the stuff half the time, it's pretty dumb stuff as well. It's not like educated. It's not well thought through. It's really emotive stuff. It's people venting and they're not actually thinking. You know, I think this is sort of thing where we are in the world now is, people should probably be registered to have a freaking social media account. There should be accountability to what you're saying and what you're doing. And
yeah,
100%.
I think that's a big thing. But look, Billy Burns, like, if he didn't go for the 5 meter, where else do you kick that ball? 15 out, 20 out, you'd be safe. And then it's so much harder to score from there than 5 meters out. You know what I mean? So I liked it. He put on the Billy, he put his big pants on, he went for it. And I agree with Ryan, like, it shouldn't come down to that moment. There's plenty of moments before that to win that game.
We're going to have to leave it there, but I definitely do feel like we probably will pick this up again because I think it is a very important topic. But Ryan, this week was short but sweet. You know, you're leaving us now to make way for our guests. So thanks for everything, as always. Today, we've got Dove Men Plus Care ambassadors Jamie Ritchie and George North joining our show. Dove Men Plus Care are a brand with care at the heart, which is why they believe in the importance of looking after yourself and others. So welcome to the show, guys. Now, before we get into rugby, George, you became a father in the summer. Congratulations. How is it all going?
Yeah, it's good. It's obviously a lot busier now. Jack has now just gone 9 months, so he is now discovered that he is now able to move without assistance. So he's crawling and trying to walk everywhere. So yeah, it's full panic stations now and trying to cover everything in bubble wrap so he doesn't hurt himself. But no, it's brilliant. It's wicked. You know what I mean? He's class, and Becky's been doing amazing as mum as well. So it makes a little less pressure off me then.
Jamie, I suppose as a dad of two, do you have any pearls of wisdom for George?
Not really. I think the best bit of advice I got was don't take anyone's advice. Like, just work it out for yourself. Kind of learning on the job is the best way to go about it. So I think whatever works for you, just go with that. Take the small wins.
There you go, Christina. Christina's learning on the job right now.
100%.
Lads, what about going away into your bubbles, like, so to speak? Is it harder when you've got kids? George, for you, you've been going away for almost a decade now, but now with Jack at home, harder for you to go away now?
Yeah, it is pretty hard. FaceTime is having a hammering, even though I don't think Jack knows what FaceTime is, but you know, it's just nice to see him and him and Becky. And it's probably harder because, you know, where I live is only just down the road from the Vale, so it's like logistically it's probably even worse knowing they're only just down the road. But it is tough, but again, we know we're in a privileged position to be able to play for our country, especially during these weird times. So It is tough, but FaceTime is the saviour. So well done, Apple and stuff.
What about you, Jamie? It's so tough, but also a lot easier because you got like your own beard. You're not homeschooling, all these sorts of things.
Yeah, it is definitely. I mean, like, your own routines are so much easier to stick to, like, especially like in the run up to games, it makes such a difference, which I think is a plus side. But for me, as it was probably different for George, like my going away from the kids has pretty much been hand in hand with my whole career. Like, Oscar was born the day I made my first start for Edinburgh. So like, I've been going away since day dot with him. So I kind of got used to it now. Like, obviously, as you say, FaceTime is brilliant and trying to FaceTime quite as much as you can. And my kids are fine. Like, they're pretty hit and miss on FaceTime. Sometimes you get their attention, sometimes they don't, but sometimes it's good to just give your missus a phone and give her an ear and see if she's been having a harder day than you, but you try not to mention how easy yours has been.
You know, that's not normal in the real world. When you retire, there's this thing called paternity leave. Like, you can take time off. I think legally from rugby, you might be able to take time off. But
I think probably, I think I was on the plane when the phone man told me that Oscar had been born, because I'd been the day before, I'd not got on the bus to travel down, and then I said I'd fly down in the morning once it was all sorted, and it took way longer than we expected, and I had to leave like halfway through, got on the plane in the morning. And then as I was like putting my phone on airplane mode, she phoned me and told me I'd been born. So I was on my way down, played 50 minutes straight off the pitch into a taxi back to the airport and flew and got off the plane straight to the hospital to go see him. So it was pretty crazy. Luckily, my second Ava, she was born a week off, so I didn't have to take it down early that time.
Yeah, so guys, I suppose the first weekend of the Six Nations, you know, you have it under your belt. So what have you both been doing to, as you know, part of your routine to recover?
You know, again, we're very lucky, obviously, playing at home. Well, we've got all our full recovery stuff here, you know. So we've got cryotherapy, you know, the pool here. We've got hot cold baths, contrast and stuff. So literally, we obviously got a short turnaround Sunday to Saturday. So it's just been a case of as much as you can, as often as you can, to feel fresh for the training days now. So, yeah, it's the old dreaded cryotherapy that works for us, as well as just doing anything to get your body right for the short turnaround.
Yeah, I think for me as well, a similar vein to George, like, we're lucky enough that where we're based here at Oakham, that we've got hot and cold baths, we've got the pool, got a masseuse with us full time and stuff, so we can utilize that. Yeah, just kind of, for us, it's about making sure you're right in yourself. I think different guys have got different preparation, so making sure that they do what they need to do to be in the best place for the weekend.
All right, well, now we can talk about rugby. So congratulations to you both for your victories over the weekend. So Jamie, I'm going to start with you. Has it sunk in yet that you're part of the first team in almost 40 years to go to Twickenham and beat the English squad at home?
Yes and no. I think the weekend was such a whirlwind. Obviously we enjoyed the evening after the game into the next day, and we had a really good time. And then, but look, it's the thing with the Six Nations, it's you're straight into it the next week. So as of yesterday, we were back prepping for Wales. So it has sunk in. I think there's been loads of messages, and we've had loads of stuff from everyone in the country. It's been brilliant to see their reaction and how much it's lifted them, which has been a great thing for us. But that was awesome. It was awesome. We loved it.
Well, in the week building up to the game, you know, can you give us an insight into the areas of England's game that you were looking to, you know, attack and disrupt, which you'd highlighted as vulnerable?
I mean, yeah, we've spoken about what we think they'd come with. Obviously, they are a team that kicks a lot, and they try and plug you down in your own half, and they're what I think they call coffin corner. So I think credit to the boys in the backfield. They were exactly where they needed to be at the weekend and kept us out of there as best they could. I think Hoggy was outstanding, and we knew that they'd try and take us on up front, so it was about us kind of fronting up there, and I think we did that at the weekend.
I want to talk to you about Finn Russell. He was absolutely on fire in the number 10 jersey at the weekend. You know, have you seen a change in him over the last 6 months or so, or is he still just getting better and better?
Yeah, I think Finn's been brilliant. I mean, unfortunately, he got injured pretty early on in the autumn, so for us, we missed him during that period, but having him back and fully into kind of his role here, it's been brilliant. Like, it's the best I've seen him in the environment. Like, the way he's been leading the boys in the attack and speaking in huddles and stuff has been like absolutely outstanding, and as I say, the best I've seen from him. So it's been brilliant to have him back, and you see the form he's been in over in France, and I think he's just bringing that into to our environment, and we're learning on the go with them, and it's brilliant to have.
And just lastly, before we do move on to you, George, I know you guys are living in a bubble at the moment, but did Gregor let you have a bit of a mini blowout on Saturday night? You know, what did you do to celebrate?
We had a few beers. That's all I kind of allude to. But yeah, no, we enjoyed our evening into the early hours.
Now, best wishes to you. I've stated publicly that you're my favourite Scottish player. Love the way you play. Nice and direct. Confrontational. Love that. And just in regards to Scotland, what we were saying before, you guys on paper have always been capable of an upset or a big result, but consistency for me. So yeah, I'd love to see you guys go beat the Welsh, the Irish and the French. George, are you muted? He's not listening.
No, George, we'll bring George in now. George, you're just one cap away from 100 for Wales. At the age of 28, I'm the same age as you. And when I read that, I was like, way to make me feel great about my life. But of the 99 caps that you've had so far, what one has been your favorite?
I think the one, it's a bit cheesy to say, but your first cap for your country is always probably the most special. I think I started off probably younger than most people would. You know, I got capped at 18, and for me, the players that I got to play with on my first cap against South Africa at home was just a bit disbelief, really. Do you know what I mean? I just come out of school. I was like, oh, I'm playing with my... essentially my heroes that I grew up watching, you know, Shane, you know, Mike Phillips, Lee Byrne, James Hook, all these guys. And then next, you know, I'm starting with them against South Africa. And I think for me, that was just a pretty, clean off moment where I just thought, what have I got? How has this come about, you know? And for me, that's probably one of my fondest memories, because it's everything you work for and, you know, train hard for to represent your country. And that was my first glimpse of it.
Awesome. Well, Wayne Pivak has promised to introduce a more attacking and exciting brand of rugby. So can you give us an insight into what you're doing in camp to try and attain that?
Yeah, do you want all our moves and plays?
Yeah.
I think as the autumn for us was always a trial period to try and give the boys that wouldn't have necessarily a lot of game time and combinations of players the opportunity to play, but very much the Six Nations now is our mindset's turned obviously to the performance and the results. Obviously against Ireland, again, we were the complete package. You know, we sort of took our foot off the gas when the red card came. I think we got a bit complacent there, where we should have really turned the screw and put a bit more pressure on that first half, certainly. And then breaking the game down, we've probably left probably two or three tries out there where realistically we got to convert them to go on and win this thing. So from our point of view, it's, as Dylan said, it's to get the first one out of the way. To get that W is huge. And that momentum, hopefully, that comes from that will hopefully inspire us to finish those opportunities and keep turning that screw and taking the next step forward.
There's a fine balance between, like, it's not even a balance. Like, people talk about entertaining brands of rugby, but, like, ultimately you want to win games, don't you? And, you know, Scotland showed at the weekend, just by playing smart rugby, they didn't have to do too much to win that game. I think, I don't know what I'm saying. I'm just making a statement, Christina. But we people talk about exciting rugby. It's like winning rugby that's ultimately what matters.
I think a point from that, Dale, is like, end of the day, we're in the results business. Do you know what I mean? I think people have a big negative feedback on, oh, we didn't score, we didn't throw the ball around, you know. But end of the day, when, you know, black and white, we're in the results business. And very quickly, if you don't get that W or the result doesn't go your way, you can win by 1 point or 100 points. It's still a W. Do you know what I mean? So, especially in these tournaments, so tough and so intense, like Six Nations, you know, ideally, you want to be scoring 5 tries, bonus point win, beautiful rugby. But end of the day, a W is a W, and it will keep you going for the next week and next week. And that momentum will bring then... hopefully the beautiful rugby from that.
I think what you were kind of saying there as well, you kind of just got through that game nicely with the W, but leaving so many opportunities out there. This is where I look at England as well, not even really throwing a punch or a shot. There's so much for them to kind of go away and look at, and you're just lucky that you're on the right side of that result and you've still got things to go and work on.
Yeah, 100%. Like, you know, you think, it's, like, as you well know, you know, boys, when you're looking at reviews in slow motion with five different camera angles, you know, rugby is real easy, but in that heat of the battle, the speed of it, you know, you can only, you know, play what you see and pull that trigger when you know it's on. And that pleasing sort of for us is the fact that we, as you said, didn't really light up an attack, but we had opportunities to do it. So, you know, it's just that next step of converting those now.
Well, Alwyn Jones was momentous, as always, in defence on Saturday. And at the age of 35, he looks better than ever. But he was nursing a big black eye during the match due to a training ground spat with fellow second row Jake Ball. So, George, can you let us know how that confrontation unfolded? And, I suppose, have the two made up?
I try and stay away from the forwards when they go about their business, just because, inevitably, you know, it's a physical game. Luckily, forwards and backs have a unit split. And from what I gather, it was quite a good unit session that obviously, as probably the boys will back me up here, I'm not a forward, but you know, when you're doing driving walls and line outs and stuff, things tend to get a bit heated. And at the end of the day, it's just rugby and those boys trying to get the best out of each other. They have made up since. It was a bit weird, but it was a bit awkward, everyone watching, but they did make up. But again, you know, those boys, you know, especially one like Al, who's been at, you know, was 195,000 caps now, and he's still going strong. And, you know, he needs, you know, those boys, you know, see what he puts in, and they need to have that edge about them going into a test match. And
I do love this. I think in every team, we've got three different teams here, but the backs, when they're this split, you kind of see them just wincing, looking over at the forwards, going, what are they doing? And then after every session, the backs will kind of sidle up to you and go, what were you guys doing today? It looked horrendous. But whenever there's a breakout in training, like, the forwards coach loves it because he knows the boys are on edge, the boys are up for it. Like, you got to think from a coach's point of view, you never want to tell the boys to kind of ramp it up. You don't want the energy to the edge to go up. The only thing you want to be doing as a coach is to tell people to simmer down, kind of calm down a bit. So I think that's just good preparation for a test match, George.
I obviously can't comment too much because they're both bigger than me. But yeah, they, again, at this level, you need that edge. You know, as the boys know, you can't go into a test match, you know, not ready or haven't, you know, crossed all the T's and dotted the I's. So sometimes it does boil over, but you know, and the end of the day, I go back to, we're in a results business. You know, we have to be ready to perform, and naturally things do get a little bit heated, but everyone's friends and everyone's made up, and no hugs because of obviously COVID, but they did knuckle it out. So
on that note, I'll let you guys go. So thanks to Dove Men Plus Care for getting George and Jamie on the show ahead of their Six Nations match at the weekend. Follow Dove Men Plus Care UK on Twitter for more rugby stories.
Last session.